Welcome to the 11th video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. In this chapter, we're going to be talking about spin. On the left, I'm showing the generalized Euler relation. This is the relationship that you get when you look at the exponential, complex exponential, not of a number, but of a 2x2 matrix. And while it looks very similar to the standard Euler relation, a cosine of the thing that's in the exponent, plus I times sine of a thing that's in the exponent, it's got this extra piece on the end, which is a matrix, and it's a bit more complicated than the traditional Euler relation, which is why we call it the generalized Euler relation. I also am showing you how you can write a state that is an upspin along an axis that's pointing in the theta phi direction. One of the things we'll talk about in this chapter is exactly how you can derive such relationships. So we're on chapter 6, spin 1/2 and polarized light. The chapter starts with a discussion of spin operators and the Leibniz rule for commutators. I really like the way that I do this in the chapter. What we do is, because of the Stern-Gerlach experiment telling us that we have states that have a positive projection and states that have a negative projection, we want to create an operator that we'll call SZ that tells us what the value of the projection is when we operate it on a state. And then we want to create another operator that we call S plus that allows us to go from a state that corresponds to a down projection into a state that corresponds to an up projection. And essentially, just from those two observations, the notion that we want to work with operators and that they do what I just described, you can actually get the SU2 algebra of spin, and that's the way in which we develop it in the book. So it really doesn't require any postulating what spin is or what the commutations are, relations are, what the operators are. It naturally arises simply by thinking carefully about what is happening in a Stern-Gerlach experiment. After that, we work with the matrix representation of spin, which gets us into the Pauli spin matrices, and from that, we can derive the generalized Euler identity using the exponential power series that we derived in the previous chapter. We also can derive the exponential disentangling identity. This is something that most people are not familiar with, but it is derived in a very easy way simply by multiplying 2x2 matrices together, and we show you all the details for how that works. We then go back and we reevaluate all of the work that we did on Stern-Gerlach experiments, but now using the Dirac notation and the operators. And it's very interesting to take those ideas that we developed as conceptual ideas for quantum mechanics and now find the formalism that goes with the conceptual ideas. I find this helps make the abstract material much more concrete for people, and I think it's a good way of starting to head towards the abstraction that we need to get into in order to describe quantum mechanics. We then do the same thing with the polarization of light experiments that we looked at, and we finally do the same thing for delayed choice experiments. All right, let's go browse through the chapter. Now, I must say, I can't think of a better quote, a more poetic way of explaining what the quantum mystery is. There's really nothing more to say except why, but since why is difficult to handle, one must take refuge in how. That's exactly what we do with our formalism. We show you how you can get the results of the quantum mystery, but we don't explain why it occurs, and we don't explain why quantum particles act this way. So let's get started. We start with our quantum formalism for spin. As I had mentioned, we have to introduce these operators, and one of the things that you get into when you work with operators is you have to work with commutators of operators. Many of the things we do in quantum mechanics involve evaluating commutators of operators, and this is one of the things that we have to do in this chapter. We get to it very early. We develop these operators that correspond to what we measured in Stern-Gerlach, which we call SZ. And then we have these operators S plus and S minus, which take us from one state to another state. And simply from that, we can get the SU2 algebra. And from that, we can then get that we can define what we would call SX and SY. And from the SX and SY, we then can look at the algebra of the SX and SY. and we get a nice mnemonic that tells us what those commutation relations are using a simple ordered mnemonic that is illustrated in this figure. And then once we have that, we start working on more complicated things such as the Leibniz rule for products of commutators. Once we have that down, we can work out the commutation relations of S squared with each of the different components of S. And that's all that we have for this section, where we've introduced the operators for spin, we've worked out their algebra, and we've started talking about what the consequences are of working with that algebra. You, of course, have a number of problems that help you work through that. Then we start working with representing the spin as a two-vector. It's sometimes called a spinner. And then we have matrices that represent the spin in this basis. And those are going to be the Pauli spin matrices. And so we develop what the Pauli spin matrices are by working with this algebra. Here they are in this equation. And of course, we pay tribute to Pauli, who is the first person to work out these matrices. We then look at how you would find spin in a particular direction along an axis that's oriented in the theta phi direction. You can do this calculation with matrices, or you can do this calculation with operators. In the book, we focus on a matrix version of it, but you can actually do it completely abstractly just with operators. And I have to tell you, in the past, when I taught my quantum mechanics class to graduate students, I often would find, if you ask graduate students to do this problem, find what a spin-up state is in a theta phi direction, they often struggle with it. They have a hard time doing it. But after you've gone through this section, you'll be able to do it really easily. Of course, we have the problems that follow this. And then we move into identities with the Pauli spin matrices. So there's a whole bunch of identities with the Pauli spin matrices. They have commutation relations. They have anti-commutation relations. They have results when you take different products with each other. And then we get the generalized Euler identity. And this is a really important one. We get it just by working with our exponential power series and recognizing what the series is for a cosine and for a sine. And then after that, we're looking at the product of an exponential and the negative of the exponential. Those should be the inverses of each other and give the unit matrix, which indeed is what they do. We look at what happens when you apply a similarity transformation to a Pauli spin matrix. And we are going to also look at products of exponentials of Pauli spin matrices. And one of the interesting things of that is you get into a problem that helps you understand what a Lie group is. So many of you have probably heard of what Lie group and Lie algebra is. By working with the Pauli matrices and exponentials of Pauli matrices, you can work out that the exponential of Pauli matrices form a Lie group. And we have a problem that tells you how that works. Then we get into the part where we're going to revisit the things that we did before. Here we're going to revisit Stern-Gerlach experiments using our Dirac notation. And there's a number of different experiments that we look at in this format. I'm not going to talk about the details. You'll be able to read about it. There's lots of interesting things you can think of how applying operators to a state are preparing a new state. And you can think of quantum experiments in terms of preparing states. One of the interesting applications we look at is what is called quantum key distribution. And then from that, we can look at the no cloning theorem. This is how quantum key distribution can be made secure. And those are very interesting applications in quantum information science and quantum communication. We then talk about polarization of light, going through looking at polarization of light in terms of our Dirac notation and working with operators. A little bit less of operators in this case. It's really more just working with that Dirac notation. But we do have to introduce tensor product states because we have polarization in addition to spatial degrees of freedom, and that's the extra aspect that we have here. And finally, we take a look at the delayed choice and quantum erasers using our Dirac notation. These are more complicated experiments, so it takes a little bit more time to go through them, and you have to be very careful with how you manipulate the different states and how you manipulate inner products that you then are going to square to determine probabilities and so forth. But we go through all of those details here. By the time you get through with this, you will really understand quantum mechanics at a very high level. I tell you, if you take anyone who took a quantum mechanics sequence taught the traditional way, and you took them and you went all the way through all of the three different years worth of classes that they took, the classes as a sophomore, the ones that they took as a junior, senior, and an undergraduate, which could have been a full year, and a full year of graduate, and you ask them to explain using Dirac-Brahn-Kett notation a particular delayed choice experiment, they would have a really tough time doing that. I bet most of them would not be able to do that. But already here, just in Chapter 6, you're able to do these things, and you're able to do them relatively easily in the way that we've been developing the theory. Okay, that's all for Chapter 6. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.